Here's a prime minister who's come to national limelight, who's been voted back to power for being an honest prime minister.
Yes.
His probity is his greatest virtue.
Right,
and
yes.
You're saying that it got squandered somewhere in the middle because of elections.
Let us take the specific dates. You're talking about 2007.
Yeah.
Everyone in government knew what was going on. It's not a secret. The Prime Minister writes to his minister, then for 2 years presides over a cabinet in which the minister's portfolio is not changed.
Yeah.
That means, what else can I say, except that the whole government is complicit?
I'm not here to defend the government.
I'm
sorry, I have a different style. I can't be that forthright, and I'm a bit conservative in that matter. And you are also, I've seen that you were conservative in many other situations, with your criticism. Let's not get into this. What I am suggesting is that quite clearly you can make out a case of omission against important people in the government. You can. But what evidence, how much of it is relevant or tenable in the court of law? And I would go along with Mr. Akbar or anyone else in agreeing that this man should not merely be dropped if he has done all this. He should be, in fact, prosecuted under the Prevention of Corruption Act because he did so as a public servant.
Mr. Akbar wants to respond to that. Is that acceptable? Because as the first amongst equals, as the Prime Minister of the country, everything ultimately goes back to the Prime Minister, no matter what he thinks about it, no matter what his personal reputation and integrity, it's criticism he cannot ward away.
My point is that here is a situation in which in 2007 the Prime Minister is made aware. The Prime Minister's Law Minister, Bhardwaj, says very clearly, look what is going on. On the recommendation of Bhardwaj, the Prime Minister writes a letter to his Law Minister, to his IT Minister, and then for 2 years does nothing. So what are we to make of this? And there's no point getting personal about it, as you are tending to do, because that's not correct for journalists to do. But here we are asking on visible facts. I am reading this and I am shocked. I am really shocked because I really did believe that the Prime Minister is honest personally.
He is honest.
No, I know he is. But
you can accuse him of an act of omission.
No, it's not. Perhaps. I mean, this
but
one.
But to suggest,
I am not suggesting.
Mr. Akbar, let us sort this out. We have seen a minister resigning from a government, going on public broadcast and telling the people that he's going to come clean and then only he's going to get back into his old job, But he comes back in the middle of the regime without even the Commission of Inquiry completing its probe. I didn't hear very many noises at that point of time.
I remember very clearly, actually, if you're referring to George Fernandez.
Yes, exactly.
Then I remember, I was presiding.
I didn't name him because he's in bad shape.
Why not? I mean, I was editor and we carried pages after pages of the transcripts which Tehelka had brought out. Printed, I think, 4 or 5 pages. Day after day, which I don't remember any other newspaper doing.
Okay, I want to bring in Ashish Khaitan. Ashish, this is not just the minister going against the advice of the law minister and the prime minister. He seems to have taken on every single official. The then telecom secretary opposed Raja's plan to palm off 2G spectrum on a first-come, first-served basis. There was a member in the Department of Telecom, member finance, who opposed this. There were officials from the finance ministry who opposed this. The law minister was vehemently opposed to all of this. Despite that, A. Raja seemed to have a plan that I will go out and auction 2G spectrum come what may.
I will make a couple of points here. There were officials within the DOT who were putting a spoke in the wheel of A. Raja because they were saying that, this is not fair, this is not transparent, this is a scam. They were very systematically, they were shunted out. And people who were more pliable, who were more convenient to A. Raja, they were brought in. And then these policies, which are completely ad hoc and, absurd, they were formulated and he went ahead with these policies. Now the communication between A. Raja and the Prime Minister, and also when you bring in Bhardwaj here, now, Bhardwaj, when he objected to A. Raja's absurd and some would say even outrageous policies of first-come, first-served basis and then the manner in which he was executing those policies, he wrote to the Prime Minister and said that, he took, shelter behind TRI's very opaque recommendations which were very old in 2001, dated 2001. And then the Prime Minister replied the same day saying that the entire process should be very fair and transparent. Again he wrote back again, he was very evasive on the issue of first come served basis / auction. He said, we will be very fair and transparent, and his objective was to bring the tariff down. Now, after writing back to the Prime Minister office, it went silent for at least 4-5 months. After 3 months, A. Raja wrote back that he is going ahead with the first come first service basis policy, and the Prime Minister merely acknowledged and didn't write back. So after the initial reservations expressed by the Prime Minister's office and by the Law Minister, after that everybody in the government went silent and A. Raja went ahead with this loot. This is very clear if you go through the investigations.